There are growing fears households could face another power price surge as the nation's oldest coal power station shuts down. For more, let's go to Liam Tapper in Sydney. Liam, the Liddell power station will start winding down from tonight.
Yeah, morning, Nat. It certainly will be. This is one of the biggest power stations here in New South Wales, and it supplies 10% of the electricity into our state. That's 8 million people whose electricity supply is set to take a hit. Now, this is going to be the first real test for the national grid when we take one of the major power stations off the grid and we rely on other alternate options. Now, AEMO, the market operator here for energy in New South Wales, they've said that supply, it should not be an issue in the short term. New South Wales, it will get electricity from Queensland and Victoria. There are also some renewables in the mix, but also we have gas. But the big question for mums and dads watching this morning will be, at what cost? Now, we know that gas, it is expensive, but also when we start taking electricity from other states, that's when the wholesale price will rise. And of course, who pays for that? Well, it's mums and dads, and it's everyday Aussie families. Now, we've seen this play out before in 2017 when the Hazelwood Power Station closed its doors in the Latrobe Valley in Victoria, well, power prices doubled. Now, this isn't expected to happen overnight, Nat. This is a 10-day process. AGL have said this will take 10 days, this closure in the Hunter Valley. But, Nat, it's the last thing that families want. It's electricity prices rising as we go into the cooler months.
Yep, winter is coming. Thank you, Liam. Here's Sherbo.
Thanks, Nat. Footy legend Gary Ablett Sr. is suing the AFL and his former clubs Hawthorn and Geelong over concussion-induced brain damage. Live to Tegan Dolling at AFL House in Melbourne. Tegan, he's claiming all three were negligent.
Yeah, good morning, Shervo. The legend has lodged his appeal in the Supreme Court this morning. And the reason for that is he says that he has got severe injuries from the concussions that he received during his playing days. 242 games for Geelong and 6 games for Hawthorn back in the 80s and 90s. He actually had a brain scan last year and that revealed that he does have a brain injury. And because of that, he says he hasn't been able to work. And that means he hasn't been able to pay his medical bills. Now, he's probably one of the biggest footy legends to come forward and blame the AFL and the clubs for his concussion-related trauma, because, Sherbo, just in the last couple of months, we've actually had 2 class actions of footballers who all say they've got the severe effects of concussion.
Yeah, it's definitely growing. A number of football codes will be watching this one very closely. Thanks, Tegan.
Yeah, won't they? Let's get some more news now. Here's Eddie.
Thank you very much. Now, we have some breaking news from overnight. 5 teenage girls have been arrested following a police pursuit in Sydney's west. Officers detected a vehicle believed to be stolen, allegedly speeding on the Great Western Highway at Bungarabee just before midnight. When they tried to stop the car, the girls sped off and the pursuit was initiated. A short time later, that car collided with a turning truck at an intersection. 5 girls fled into nearby bushland, but they were soon taken into custody. The alleged 17-year-old driver was treated by paramedics for dog bites suffered during the arrest. Police are investigating after a man's body was discovered following a house fire in Melbourne's northeast. Emergency crews were called to a home in Heidelberg West just before 1 this morning following reports of a fire. A man's body was discovered inside. A crime scene has been established and anyone with information is urged to contact Crime Stoppers. The federal government will today announce a crackdown on the National Disability Insurance Scheme, flagging it's in need of an urgent reboot. 7 News political reporter Rachel Baxter is in Canberra. Rachel, NDIS Minister Bill Shorten will outline his plan today.
Good morning, Eddie. Yeah, he'll make a pre-budget speech to the National Press Club today, and it's there he'll reveal details of a fraud task force that's been set up to review the scheme. Right now, that task force has 38 investigations underway involving more than $300 million in payments, and last month it received more than 1,700 tip-offs about people trying to rip off the system. He'll also flag the government's plan to shake up the NDIS in a bid to control the ballooning costs, which is expected to hit almost $90 billion a year by 2032. In fact, the Treasurer has flagged this week that the scheme is the second fastest growing demand on the budget, coming in behind interest payments on debt. So that's a big burden, Eddie.
Yes, certainly is. Thank you, Rachel. An Australian man has died while walking the Kokoda Trek in Papua New Guinea. It's believed the 48-year-old passed out during the trek. Bystanders attempted CPR before he died at Port Moresby's Pacific International Hospital. A car resembling a Chinese police vehicle has been spotted in southeast Melbourne. Let's go to Nathan Curry in Melbourne. Nathan, do we know who or what is behind this?
No, not yet, Eddie, but it's a real strange one. It's got a lot of people on social media a bit baffled. Pictures are doing the round of a dark Nissan sedan with Chinese characters on the front and the side and a Chinese police badge on the door. A lot of people are speculating what it could be. A lot of people are saying, could it be a spy? I don't think it could be a spy because the car looks pretty obvious. So if it was a spy, I don't think they're doing their job quite well. It looks like, according to a lot of people, that it could be just a prank. Some Chinese students did a similar thing a few years ago in Perth and in Adelaide with an identical looking car. Spoken to Victoria Police this morning, it's definitely not one of their cars. They've received no reports about it doing anything suspicious at this stage. So hopefully, Eddie, it is just a prank.
Yeah, a bit of a mystery. Thank you, Nathan. An iconic Australian hotel has been dealt a massive blow with luxury brand Versace deciding not to renew its branding agreement. Let's go live to Tamara Bo, who's at the Gold Coast Palazzo Versace Hotel. Tamara, this was rumoured, but now it's final.
Oh, exactly, Eddie. And what it means for the Gold Coast, it remains to be seen whether this is a good thing for tourism. Many people are saying it looks a little bit tired and does need a refurb. But look, either way, this isn't the end of an era. This has been a part of our Gold Coast skyline for more than two decades. When it launched in the year 2000, it was the first branded property to be linked with a fashion house. And then that idea took off worldwide. But now we understand that the owners of the property have recently headed to Milan, Italy, to Versace HQ to try and broker a deal for the $100 million property moving forward, but with whispers that it wasn't kept up to the Versace standard, we understand an agreement could not be reached. And with that comes a rebrand and a $70 million refurb as well, because thousands of tiny little Medusa tiles, as well as that big iconic Medusa head up top, will need to be removed from the property when that branding deal ends mid-year. But Eddie, a little piece of Versace will remain, the beautiful opulent chandelier in the foyer that once belonged to Gianni Versace himself.
Big reno ahead. Thank you, Tamara.